By way of a disclaimer, these guys behind me, a lot of beginners except like two guys, and it's a very quiet night because we're in Golden Week. We're about to be in Golden Week, so everyone's, no one's really here. But anyway, my point is that they are doing progressive sparring drills, okay, to enhance their skills and abilities in being able to read oncoming attacks that are random and deal with them, basically counter. There's a very, very fundamental concept going on behind me right now. But all that shit aside, right, what I want to mention right now is something that I get asked all the time, and I got asked this last time I was in LA, I was teaching a seminar, I'm about to go back and do another one. I get asked it if I was in Australia the other week, here in Japan, everywhere, absolutely everywhere, and even in the UK. What is the law of self-defense? Now, it changes, believe it or not, even from city to city, because when I was bouncing back in Australia, we had liquor licensing laws that will ban you from a premises, and will get you banned from everywhere in that area. So it did actually change from city to city, depending on the area. You know, you've got national, like federal laws, you've got state laws, and then you've got bylaws of that city. So for any martial arts instructor, combatives instructor, self-defense instructor, whatever, to try and tell you what the fucking law is, they'd want to be a cop or a lawyer, okay? So I'm always starting off seminars by saying this and ending in the same way, saying I'm in no position, morally nor legally, to tell you what is right or wrong in terms of how to defend yourself. What my job is to give you skills. Right, so our training is based on, it's a very basic progressive drill they're doing behind us, and again, they're beginners, so don't judge me. But I'm just saying that, you know, our objective is to create, develop, and maintain functional skills, okay? And as I said, it's progressive, so they're breaking it down. But when you go to apply that shit, you know, when we do Tuesday nights is more so concept-based and simulation stuff, Wednesday night is progressive sparring like it is now. When you go to apply that stuff, all of these things, you cannot say, you know, A, B, or C, whichever one is the most realistic, because they are just one part or one element of training that will develop a certain attribute. Okay, it's up to you how you apply yourself in the situation. It does not matter what happens, it's up to you how you apply yourself. So having said that, what is the most, the best way to defend yourself, and what is the lawful way to defend yourself? Well, the answer is this. No matter where I've gone, I think we've got a bleeder. No matter where I've gone, it's always the same, that when you defend yourself, it has to be reasonable and necessary in the eyes of the law. Not just you, it's in the eyes of the law, okay? So when you articulate your actions, which I had to do all the fucking time, right? Both in Australia, here, and everywhere else I've worked. Whenever there's been an incident, there are several, most nights, you know, you'd have to write it up. And most of the time, what I saw, and I even encountered this when I was a lot younger, was people mix up fact and opinion. They forget that their opinion doesn't fucking matter, and that fact is the only thing that does actually matter. And also, a while back, what, you know, people talk about what's permissible in court and all this sort of thing. That's a little bit different. I'm talking about the round two, when the law, when you have to deal with the law, as in the authorities, when law enforcement shows up and explain why you did that. So, you know, a lot of the time, not just what you did, why you did it, a lot of time how you did it, and if you can explain when the situation as well, it can sort of help you out, you know. But if you're drunk or something and you're going to get into a scrap, the chances of you being able to articulate your actions and prevent yourself from losing your freedom or your job or whatever else it is that could be at stake is very slim. So, you know, to avoid, if you're a little bit hot-tempered, don't go out and drink, simple stuff like that. But to get back to my original topic, to get back to my original point, you know, you have to be able to act or react within reasonable, necessary use of force. So, the use of force, what we use in training a lot of time is a use of force continuum, and that's always adapted and applied based on the group that I'm training. So if they're security police or military, it could be based on their ROE, it could be based on their department policies. You know, certain departments I'm trained, they'll say, okay, you can, like I was working with guys from a correctional facility in North Carolina, and they could use anything they've been taught. Whereas other groups I've trained, they were like, okay, this is not department approved. If you use that, you're on your fucking own. So they could have a civil lawsuit, they could lose their job, and all these other issues could occur. So that's why martial arts and combatives is two separate things. And one of our courses actually just got approved by the state of Maryland for EMS. Was it EMS or EMT? Whatever it is. you know, the paramedics. So you can look that up in Royal Combat Medic Atlantic. They're they just have their course state approved. Now, again, when you are going to try and attempt to defend yourself, it's important that you remember what is reasonable and necessary, and it's fact. It's based on the eyes of the law. So, in the eyes of the law. So, for example, someone pushes you and you punch him in the throat, or you kick him in the balls, and you stomp him and whatever. Is that reasonable or necessary? Think about it real quick. Probably fucking not, right? I'll say this. I don't want to rant too much, but I'll say this. I've worked with several people that have spent time in jail for excessive use of force, grievous bodily harm. And I know a guy, I'm not really friends with his acquaintance, but I've known him for some time. He was a little bit crazy, and recently I said to him, dude, why the fuck are you so mental? You know, what's with you? He goes, I'm just trying to live, man. You know, he's here, he's in Japan. He said, I'm just trying to live, man. I said, what's your deal? And he goes, I was away for 5 years, as in he was in jail 5 years. And what for? He said, manslaughter. He punched a guy one time. He had a fight. It was a range fight. He was like, fuck you. The other guy's, yeah, fuck you too. You want to go? Yeah, let's go. And everyone was there. He got one punch. He punched the guy back. The guy fell over, smashed his head, and he died then and there. Just cracked his head, broke his fucking skull or his neck, whatever. I can't remember the exact, whatever it was. The guy did 5 years. He lost 5 years of his life. Okay. I've worked with a couple other guys that did a year or two here or there. I know another guy in Oz that did 5 years, actually. One situation I remember, he got pushed, he punched the guy back. He was already on some sort of reprimand. He was on probation or whatever. The guy went down and he kicked him, and he went to jail for that because it was just one step above what was reasonable and necessary. Yes, one punch could have done it. One punch could have killed the guy as well. But, you know, he kicked the guy with his down. Another guy I trained with back in the day, back when I was a fucking kid, did Taekwondo, I think it was, and he kept doing that. I did a lot of other shit. But one guy, I think, tried to punch him, and he ended up pulling off some jumping, spinning fucking kick or whatever. And, you know, he hit this guy in the head and killed him. And he went to jail for manslaughter as well. So, you know, a lot of guys that do martial arts, you know, like I said, this is one part of our training. This is not all of it. You know, if you're only focusing on one thing and you're not sort of conscious about how you're going to apply this shit in reality, you know, I think you should really have a look at what you're doing and why you're doing it, and remember that it's not what you do, it's how you do it, okay, and how you apply yourself. So that's really all I'm going to say. I think my best word of advice would be to look up your laws online on an official government website and go and visit your local police department and say, hey, what's the law regarding this? And ask them questions, because a law enforcement officer or law professional can actually give you the correct answer. But in my experience, that's what it is, that's what it's about. And pretty much everywhere I've been, I just had a police inspector here from the Kansai area. And he said to me as well, yeah, it's the same thing here. We're talking a lot about it with incidences that we've been involved in. And a few things he's been involved in, he's like, fuck, where was that? I've had the same. It's how you articulate it. It's not exactly what you do all the time, it's how you articulate it. So that's what's kept my freedom and my job a lot of times. So anyways, I hope that's helped out. That's the most realistic and honest response I can give. We've got to get back to class because these guys are going to go and do open sparring every second. It's been polishing those basics. So if you want to see more realistic training, see the other videos on the channel, make sure you subscribe and check out our online learning center for a free week-long trial. Keep it rolling.